Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Grace and the Lord. What a joy to have you here today. We have people from all sorts of different backgrounds. It's always a cool thing about what we do here in the Lord. Whether you're a first-time visitor or you've been here a number of times, we're going to enjoy spending some time together in God's Word. And I know that the Lord's going to touch your heart and draw you closer to Him through His Word today, too. Hopefully you grabbed a handout on the entry table here. This will help you as we walk through God's Word before us this morning. And if you are joining us online, you can go to gracedowntown.org/docs, and you can find the handout there to follow along with us today, too. We're continuing our August series, taking a look at this idea, this topic of the bread that gives life. I will hold off on some more thoughts here in just a moment. But before we go too far, why don't we ask God to bless our time with Him today? So we join together in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for the gift of this day, the gift of a place where we can gather to hear Your Word, and the gift of Your mercy and grace. And it's that for which we give the most thanks for this morning, that You would send Your Son Jesus and give us an opportunity to know Him and to grow in understanding and faith in Him. And it's that understanding and faith, Lord, that we ask You to bless us with and strengthen in us this morning as we draw nearer to You through Your Word. We ask these things in the name of our Savior Jesus. Amen. So if you've been with us for the last couple of weeks, you would have heard us talking about bread, and we are still talking about bread. So if you're here for the first time today, you're like, all right, well, the first time we're talking about bread. Hopefully, though, if you've been with us, you're not sick of bread yet. As I have shared, I love bread, so I'm not going to get sick of this series at all, right? But we're looking at this series of John, of the bread of life, this discourse and reading that comes from the Gospel of John chapter 6. And we start off by taking a look at this marvelous miracle in which Jesus fed more than 5,000 people with just a couple loaves of bread and a few fish. And He fed them so abundantly and with so much food that they were all satisfied and had 12 baskets full of food left over. And it was absolutely stunning. And then Jesus and the disciples head across the Sea of Galilee, which is His own unique story and account. But the crowd chases after because they thought, this is awesome. We want Jesus to be our leader and to just feed us like this every day. We're going to have pantries that are full of food. We won't have to work hard for it. We'll never run out. We want Jesus. But as we've been looking at, we realize that they were chasing after Jesus for the wrong reason. And Jesus realized this, and the rest of John chapter 6, the large chunk of it, is His sermon, His conversation He has with them about what He is really all about. He's not just about feeding our stomachs, but about feeding our souls. And He uses this beautiful illustration of the bread of life that He calls Himself. So today we're going to continue by looking at what is in this bread of life. What is it made of? What are the ingredients of it? And really, too, what then does that do for you and me? And so to kind of get thinking in this subject this morning, I want to start with this first question for you to reflect on. How good of a baker are you? First of all, anybody here a big baker? No? All right, this actually is really good then. So nobody can argue with me when I give you a recipe. Okay? See how many ingredients that you can think of that are needed to make a loaf of regular white bread. Right? So just say, hey, you want to bake bread when you get home this afternoon? List as many ingredients that you can think of would go into it, and we'll share some in a moment, right? Loaf of bread. Anybody want to share? Yeah, go ahead.
Egg, milk, flour, yeast, butter, baking powder, and salt.
Alright, what do you guys think? It might work. Alright, good. Any other things that you would add to it?
When I would make bread in my bread maker, you would have salt and sugar.
Alright, salt and sugar and yeast, good. Anything else? I think those are all good sounding ingredients, right? You know, the basics, I had Googled this, what are the basic ingredients you need for bread? And literally you need like two ingredients. You can make it super duper simple with just flour and water, right? But that doesn't sound super appealing, right? So you need a couple more, right? So flour, water, and yeast are like your basic things, because the yeast helps it rise and give it that nice fluffiness to it. But then, you know, it's still maybe a little bland, so a lot of recipes will add a little salt, maybe a little sugar, and then you can just start getting crazy and wild with all the different types of breads and all the other different ingredients that go with it. But I think you guys would pass. So if you want to go home this afternoon and make yourself a loaf of bread, you want me to taste test it. I'm brave enough to taste test the bread. All right? But I think you'll have a simple recipe set up in front of you. All right? The point being, though, is you want to have the right ingredients. Because if you go out and you start experimenting, maybe you'll start adding some things and maybe you'll forget something. Maybe you'll forget to add the yeast. Well, your bread's going to be pretty flat. Not all that great. Or maybe you're going to forget, maybe you forgot the salt and you're thinking, oh man, this is bland, or the sugar that you needed with it, or you didn't add enough water and so that was really a crumbly loaf of bread, or you didn't add enough flour and it's just really drippy and soggy kind of. So I mean, getting the ingredients right, if you're going to be a great baker of bread, you need to get the ingredients right. The same is true when it comes to our relationship with God. As we're going to explore today, there are all sorts of ingredients that we try to throw into our relationship with God, into our life, and how we're going to get close to God and live with Him. But let's be honest, we don't always get the ingredients right. So when it comes to the bread of life, when it comes to knowing Jesus and understanding who He is, we want to make sure that we have the right ingredients. And so this morning, as we explore this discussion about Jesus being the bread of life, we're going to look at what goes into it and why that's important for us. So let's dive into the Word of God. I'm going to invite you to join with me in turning, if you'd like, to John chapter 6. We're beginning verse 41 this morning. So if you have a Bible you'd like to open up, or you have your Bible app on your phone, open up. You can do that. I'll have the words up here on the screen for you. A little bit later on, you might want them as we discuss it. So as I said, Jesus had just performed this beautiful miracle of feeding 5,000 people. He's gone across the Sea of Galilee. The crowd chases him down. They want him to be their leader. But Jesus said, I have something way better to give you than just food for your stomachs. I have something greater, and this is what Jesus is sharing with them here. So John chapter 6, verse 41 and following. I should highlight this. So just prior to this, Jesus said, I am the bread of life. I'm the one who is promised. I'm the one whom God is sending to give you eternal life. And now follows this. At this, the Jews there began to grumble about him because he said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. They said, is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he now say, I came down from heaven? Stop grumbling among yourselves, Jesus answered. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws them, and I will raise them up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, they will all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard the Father and learned from him comes to me. No one has seen the Father except the one who is from God. Only he has seen the Father. So after Jesus shares with the crowd that he has something way better to give them than just bread, because they kind of referred back to how in the Old Testament God had given bread from heaven to his people of Israel in a special, unique way. That's kind of what they wanted. Jesus said, I got something better. I'm the bread of life, and I'm going to give you real life. But they started grumbling. It's kind of a something that we often hear with people when they're confronted with God, as they grumble. People of Israel grumbled and complained after some time after getting this bread from heaven. They're like, well, now we're sick of this bread. We want something else. They grumbled and complained after they were set free from slavery in Egypt and were actually on their way to the promised land, but it wasn't quick enough, it wasn't fast enough, it wasn't easy enough, and so they grumbled and complained. And even now, Jesus is offering these Jewish people, this crowd of people, something far better than any kind of refrigerator or pantry full of food, and yet they're still grumbling. But why? Take a moment to think about this. Analyze the grumbling of the Jews in verses 41 and 42. I'm going to have those verses again up here on the screen in just a moment. But as you're analyzing the grumbling of this crowd, compare that to the grumbling about Jesus that still takes place today. Because let's be honest, the cycle still continues. People still grumble and complain when they're confronted by what Jesus has to offer. So take a moment to analyze the grumbling of the crowd and compare it to the grumbling taking place today. And take a few moments to do it. Feel free to chat with someone sitting next to you. So how do you view this grumbling that the Jewish people had after Jesus said he was the bread that came down from heaven? What do you see there? Why were they grumbling? Any thoughts? Yeah, please.
I thought that oftentimes God's truth comes against what we expect. Like maybe we already have pictured in our mind like what the answer to our prayer is going to look like. The Messiah to look a certain way or be a certain way, and he's not at all what they expected, and so they are grumbling at everything he does.
When you don't get what you expect, you grumble, you complain, you're disappointed, right? And that's, I think, what we see here. The Jewish people were expecting probably two different things. First of all, they were expecting Jesus to just be their leader and to give them food each day. And that's what they were wanting. When he says, no, I got something better, right? Well, I don't know if I really want that bread, Jesus. And then when he says, well, I'm the one who has promised to come to be the Savior, to bring you to God and give you eternal life. Well, then they start grumbling and complaining again because, well, no, because you don't look like who we expect you to be. We expect the Savior to come in great power, and he's going to set up this earthly kingdom, and he's going to bring us this wonderful peace and prosperity here on this earth. And you don't look like the Messiah. In fact, we know your dad. He's Joseph, the carpenter guy. No, you're not the Savior. And so for Jesus to claim these things, they said, no, you can't be it. Any other reasons maybe why they were grumbling about Jesus' claims here? That come to your mind? Oh, go ahead.
Well, I was going to say one thing we talked about, kind of the feedback off it is by fact versus by faith. So they're going off the facts of, well, he was born of a human, like, father and mother, and that how could that be that he could be some
Yeah, so this difference between fact and faith, and looking at what we see sometimes doesn't always match with what we expect either. But a lot of what Jesus has for us and what God has for us is based on faith and simply believing Him, trusting in Him with our hearts. A lot of times, too, you know, these people might have looked at Jesus as not being what they needed. Why do we need you to be the bread of life when we're pretty content with what we have here in this life, right? If you're not going to feed us, then we really don't need you for anything else. And sometimes I think we can look at it that way too. Or maybe they've become so fattened and filled up, not with the bread that they've just eaten the day before, but fattened with themselves. Why do we need what you have, Jesus? Life is good. We're good with God because we've got His laws. We've got His commands. We're sitting in the synagogues every Sunday. Jesus, why do we need you? We're doing right with God on our own. But Jesus had to correct them and show them what we do on our own isn't good enough. We need a Savior to bring us into the righteousness of the eternal God. So compare the grumbling of the people of Israel, these Jewish people, this Jewish crowd that is around Jesus, compare that with the grumbling about Jesus that takes place today. Similar, not similar? Any thoughts on that?
Yeah. Looking at the timeline a little bit, he said, "I am the Messiah, the promised one," and there's a no, you know, we're waiting for the big pomp and glory to overthrow the Romans, and we grumble about the timeline of God's actions. And we want it now, or it wasn't fast enough, or it wasn't good enough, and I saw that as a similarity.
All right, so sometimes we still have the same type of expectations from God. And if it doesn't play out the right way in our lives, we grumble and complain, don't we? If God doesn't let our career go in the path that we were expecting, or the relationship to work out the way that we wanted it to, or the health issue to go away, to be fixed, to have recovery the way that we really wanted to and to enjoy life, we often are tempted to grumble, complain, and to think God doesn't have what we want. In fact, sometimes don't we even say God's just not the flavor of bread that we want? Now imagine a kid, you know, coming down for breakfast, and there's just this table full of beautiful different breads, you know, all sorts of fruit breads, like blueberry bread and cherry bread, and maybe some apple crumble bread and banana bread, and you look at, and they're just beautiful, they smell so good, but you look around and like, you got any white bread? I'd rather have that. And maybe that's sometimes how we are with God too. He offers up this beautiful table full of all these blessings He wants to give you in your life. And we look at it and say, I'd rather have something else. And it's often because we get fattened up on our own self-righteous attitudes too. We don't like to hear the sometimes bitter tasting news that we're a bunch of sinners. We don't like to think about death, being separated from God, and maybe a topic like hell. But often that's all that we get to taste, unless we have Jesus. But so often we go to what we're comfortable with, don't we? We want the white bread. Maybe wheat bread, if that's your thing. And we want to go back to that. Even though God has all these different blessings, they may not be of our taste, they may not be the flavor our mouth is so used to, but Jesus here sets before these people, here is life, I'm it. And they grumble and complain. And I think it's because they didn't quite realize what the ingredients were of this bread. And so Jesus takes a moment to explain to them, this is why I am the bread of life. This is why I can save you. And that's what he gets into in these next verses, because he points them in verses 43 and following, verse 44 and following, he points them to the Father. He says, you're trying to get close to the Father. Well, the only way you're going to know the Messiah, the only one way you're going to know life is by knowing the one whom God has sent to you. And if you look at this, everything keeps pointing right back to Jesus. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws them, and I will raise them up at the last day. Jesus is the one who's going to be able to do this. Everyone who has heard the Father and learned from Him comes to me. So if you're really listening to God and His Word, it points to Jesus. And really, that's the whole Old Testament. In fact, not just the Old Testament, the whole Bible points to Jesus. From the very beginning, when God created a perfect world and was ruined by sinful actions, God pointed to Jesus. He said, I'm going to send one who's going to destroy Satan's work and bring you back to me. And throughout the rest of the Old Testament, it's all about God keeping a special people through whom he's going to send that Savior and directing them and pointing them to Jesus. And the rest of it's all the story of Jesus and what that now means for us. So Jesus is speaking truth here. Everyone who's heard from the Father, learned from him, comes to me. No one has seen the Father except the one who is from God. Only he has seen the Father. So if you want to be right with God, look at me. I'm the one. I'm the one and the only one who can bring you real life. Because you cannot come to the Father on your own. You cannot have a relationship with God on your own, because your sinful actions, your disobedience, as much as you try and as good of efforts as you put in, are not going to draw you near. Only through Jesus. And so Jesus gets into this idea of what's really important, why he is the bread of life. Why he is the only one who can offer that life, because he is the Savior. So I want you to think about this. First of all, why do people read the nutrition labels on food packets? I'll just open that up to you as a crowd here.
For bodily health. Like, we know what we're supposed to have, we know what's good for us, what's bad for us, and that informs it.
Yeah, so for bodily health, for a good diet, right? You take a look at it so that you can find out what's in it, right? Why else? For allergies, right? Maybe you're looking for stuff. I'm allergic to nuts, or I'm allergic to gluten, or whatever it might be, and all right, I gotta read the ingredient label and see what's in it, right? But a lot of times we do this for good health, and maybe you're not a label reader at all. That's totally cool, right? But sometimes if you are a little bit more health conscious and you're concerned about what you're putting in your body, you're gonna look at what is this food made of, what kind of nutrients is it giving me, and those types of things too. I think we need to do this with the bread of life. We need to understand what's in it, what it is that it gives to us. So what I have for you is I want you to take a crack at creating a nutrition label for the bread of life, Jesus Christ. So you have one on your handout there, and I'd love for you to take a moment or two to complete this nutrition fact label for the bread of life. Be as creative as you would like, but we'll share some thoughts here. I completed one for you too in just a moment. But take a moment to think about it and feel free to discuss too. Creating a nutrition label for the bread of life. Anybody want to offer up maybe some of the things that you included on that label that you put together? All right.
So then, like, the people around you are, have your spiritual health in mind.
Oh, absolutely. Good. Very good. It's the spiritual health that we receive from that. All right. Please.
I put serving size, a whole lot of Jesus.
Good.
Calories enough for everlasting life.
Beautiful.
100% forgiven, 0% my effort, 100% Jesus, and words to live by.
I love that. Very nice. And that's very similar to what I'm going to share with you, too. Any other things that you would add or share?
Serving size was eternal, and that the calories were perfectly individualized. So depending on your struggles for each day, it might be more one day than less on another day.
Absolutely. Yeah, God gives us his grace just as we need it. That's a beautiful thought, too. Thank you. Anything else? Well, let me share with you what I put together. And it's very similar to a lot of the things that you've already thought about and put on yours, too. Serving size, a daily intake, right? So a daily amount of the bread of life. That's, I mean, you can't eat enough of the bread of life. So if you think you're eating enough, keep on eating it, right? And when we talk about the bread of life, calories don't count, right? So when you're in church, it's like eating the donuts on Sunday mornings when we had donuts and we bring those back again. Donuts and calories don't count on Sunday mornings, right? Because the amount per serving we're having a little issue with clicking on stuff. Now, eternal life is what we have, and the calories that we need for our life. And then when it comes to the nutrition and value that comes out of it, 100% grace. And I almost would have put that infinite sign next to it. I mean, it's just, we're always going to receive this grace, 100% of God's grace, 100% forgiveness. And that's one of these beautiful things. This grace, this undeserved love, that we deserve nothing from God for the sinners that we are. And yet he sends us his love, his grace, and his forgiveness that God has given you, 100% forgiveness, because Jesus has paid the debt for you and taken away your sins. So you are completely forgiven. You have 100% peace because you know that your life with God is secure and you know that you have eternal life. And so even when the world is crumbling down around you and it's super stressful and it's not going the way you want, there's still peace because I know God is with me and that's secure. There's 100% joy, which as Christians we can have, that even in the moments of sorrow and challenges in life, we can have the joy that can only be found in the bread of life. And 100% freedom, that we are completely set free from the chains of death. We are completely set free from Satan and his efforts of drawing us away. We're completely set free from our sins and our guilt. And these last things, there's 0% guilt in the bread of life, because Jesus has lifted that off of you. So the things that Satan wants you to hang on to and just drag you down with, Christ has set you free from that and taken that guilt away. 0% shame. There is no more shame. And I know that we can be tempted to hang on to our past and just feel like God could never love me. We're embarrassed about what we've done. But Christ knows that he's taken you and setting you free from that. And 0% condemnation. You know, you know, sometimes you eat too many donuts, you know you're going to be sick in the morning. And you know it's not going to be good for your body, right? But you cannot eat enough bread, the bread of life, and ever know that sin or that eternal life is taken from you. No, there's no condemnation in Christ. Keep eating that, because Christ has taken away the punishment for your sins. He takes away the judgment of God, so God declares to you, you're forgiven. You are not guilty. You are my child. There's no fear of having to stand before God and hearing him say, get out of my sight. In Christ, you are God's very own child. That's what the bread of life gives to you. And I have, and it didn't show up on your handout here, but at the very bottom, maybe you listed some ingredients. Honestly, in this recipe for the bread of life, there's only one ingredient. And that one ingredient is Jesus. Jesus and his life, Jesus and his blood, Jesus and his suffering, Jesus on the cross, Jesus risen from an empty tomb is what makes this bread the life-giving source that we so desperately need in our hearts and our lives too. So enjoy that bread. This is exactly what you need. It's got the perfect ingredients of our Savior Jesus and will never disappoint. Let's join together in singing the praises of our Lord with our first song this morning, a song called The Lord is My Salvation. I'm going to invite you to stand, and feel free to jump in singing as you feel comfortable. You're also just welcome to just sit and enjoy the words too.
Be of God.
after Jesus spent some time sharing the reason he's the bread of life and why he's the perfect ingredient, the one sent from God, the one who can draw us to the Lord through his word, Jesus then goes in to share the eternal benefits that we have when we eat of the bread of life. So turn with me again to John chapter 6. We're continuing on at verse 47 through 51. Jesus said this, "Very truly I tell you, the one who believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, yet they died. But here is the bread that comes down from heaven, which anyone may eat and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world." Hopefully you are seeing the eternal benefits that Jesus has here as the bread of life. But as he shares the eternal benefits, it makes us think about, man, what are the things that are keeping me from eternal life? What are the things that are ruining my spiritual health? So what I want you to think about is that for a moment. Just like any time you're considering the health of your body, you got to take a look at what are the things that are affecting it. What are the things that are keeping me from losing weight or not being as healthy as I want to be or whatever it might be? We have to consider our diet. We have to consider our exercise routine, all those types of things. The reality is we have to do that when it comes to our spiritual life with God too. So take a moment to reflect on that. List things in your life that you need to cut out of your spiritual diet for better spiritual health. I'm going to give you a moment to reflect on that, and if you'd like to share some of those ideas with someone, please do that. Reflecting on what types of things you need to cut out of your life for your spiritual health is a good exercise and practice to look at what are the things that are keeping me from my Savior, from keeping me from having the things that the bread of life offers, that knowing that I'm fully forgiven, that I have no more guilt, that I don't have to fear condemnation or death, to feel the joy and the comfort and the peace and the freedom of life with Jesus. It's good for us to reflect on those things because too often, let's be honest, just like we have cheap days in life, and maybe just you go home and like, I don't want to eat nothing but Doritos and junk food, right? We have those moments spiritually too, where we go back to the things that really just make us spiritually unhealthy. We can either continue to sit on that and continue to fatten up and die spiritually, or we can find our strength and hope in Jesus. And ask him for his strength to overcome those things too. So to reflect on these things is good. What are the bad things in my life spiritually that I need to get rid of? It's also a personal reflection and a moment to think about your own life. So I'm not going to necessarily put you on the spot, but if anybody would like to share something spiritually in your diet that you need to get rid of, or something that's common for us to get rid of, I'd love for you to share. Otherwise, I have a list of things that are pretty common to us too, but would anyone like to share some things that they've cut out?
Okay. So first, there's the cut off with the scissors versus cut with a scalpel. There's things that you need to cut off and just stop doing, and there's that you need to be a little bit more, I say you can cut off part of it.
Yeah, good.
You said vanity, money, social media, specifically Netflix. different members of support groups, so friends you have a relationship with, but perhaps isn't the healthiest of relationships.
Yeah, I think those are all great things. You know, these things that, anything that draws me away from my Savior. And there are so many things that you just identified, social media and TV and things like that that can draw us away. So sometimes we need to cut those out, or at least use them, like the scalpel, in a better, more godly way, right? But I think you hit on an important one too, relationships. Sometimes we just crave relationships so much that we end up in relationships that aren't very spiritually healthy for me. A relationship that draws me away from a stronger connection with God, and as challenging as those can be sometimes to step away from that relationship, or to at least better address that relationship too. Very good. Other things that spiritual you need to cut out of your spiritual diet. Other things that are simple things too, and maybe are on your list, things like just false teachings. There are so many, just like there are when you go to the grocery store and you go into the health section and each one wants to claim to be the best food, right? And the best one for your exercise, or the best diet pill or diet bar, or whatever it is. Sometimes you have to actually look at the ingredients and see, how is that so healthy when it's got that much sugar in it? Or this or that or that many calories, right? And the same is true in our world when it comes to our faith. There are so many churches and faiths that claim we've got it all figured out, we're the best, and yet you look at really what the ingredients of what they're teaching are, and it might make you feel really good, but it's just going to fatten you up on yourself because it doesn't have enough of Jesus and the grace of God in it. And so to look at those types of things and not be pulled away by false teachings that are going to take Jesus completely out of the ingredients mix, but to make sure he's there. But then just things that are in my own life, this maybe even similar to my physical health, things like laziness, spiritual laziness, where I haven't spent time with Jesus in a while, and I feel like it. Or complacency, where I feel like I'm just in a good spot. I don't really need a whole lot of Jesus right now. Things like doubts and fears that take my eyes off of Jesus and keep me far from him too. We need to cut those things out. And just keep coming back to Jesus, because he's the thing that truly feeds our souls. So we need to sometimes take a look at my spiritual health, and what am I eating? Am I eating of the bread of life to have that eternal life? Now, as Jesus shared in these verses, these last verses, there are so many eternal benefits that we have it from him. And just like if you run across this super great diet food or diet or whatever else, or exercise regimen, you just sing the praises of it. Let's take a moment to sing the praises of our bread of life. So take a moment to sing the praises of the benefits that come from eating the bread of life. Reflect again on those verses that we just read. And what are the eternal benefits that you see there? Blessings that you want to continue to gain from eating of the bread of life. We'll share some thoughts in just a moment. Thank you. Wonder Bread, the specific, you know, brand of bread. They at one time touted the fact that they had 15 different vitamins and nutrients in this bread. Right, so super healthy, and like you're gonna get your daily intake of everything that you need to stay healthy by eating this bread. It just touted the blessings of eating it. We have bread that has, I think, far more than just 15 blessings in eating of it, and that's the bread of life in Jesus. And I don't know if we'll come up with a list of 15 specific things this morning as we sit here, but to realize the blessings that they are to have and to eat of the bread of life is so important for us, not just to know and trust in our hearts, but to proclaim and share in our lives to many other people too. So let's put together a list of blessings that we can sing the praises of as we eat of the bread of life. Anyone want to start us off with some tremendous blessings? Please.
Any outside of eternal life, like just, I think a shift in perspective that we have immediately, knowing that we have like peace and confidence, assurance that everything happening in this world doesn't matter.
Absolutely. So that change of heart and attitude that Jesus gives to us. And that's what Jesus comes to do, because our attitudes are so often focused inwardly or looking at the world rather than looking at Jesus. And when we see Jesus, it just shifts everything. The way I interact with the world, the way I view the world, the way I view other people, because it's through the lens of my Savior Jesus who gives me life. And I can reflect that life to others. Other eternal blessings. And actually, you mentioned one that I don't want to overlook at all because it's almost too simple, but it's the biggest one. It's eternal life. It's life with God forever, to be in the presence of God. As Jesus said earlier, to draw us to the Father, that we may be one with Him. It's the eternal blessing that we have. And it's actually interesting in these few verses that are here, 47 through 51, guess how many times Jesus talks about life or mentions life in words and phrases? It's about 6 times. We could probably even count 7 if you go with the negative of the you'll not die, right? So again and again, this is the benefit. You have life. You have life now to enjoy with God in this world. You have life eternal that is yours. You don't have the fear that's going to be taken from you because it is secure in Christ. That is your blessing. Other blessings that come from eating of the bread of life. Please.
Hope,
love, comfort, and grace. Absolutely. To continue to dwell in the undeserved love of God each day. Because let's be honest, as filled up as we can be with Jesus right now, we're going to go out into the world and we're going to have our moments where we slip back into sin and the bad eating habits spiritually. But to know God's grace paid for those sins too is tremendous. And to have the hope of life with God is so beautiful too. Other blessings that we would sing the praises of from the bread of life.
Gives you purpose.
Gives you purpose. Purpose and strength, that purpose. Purpose that is not just about surviving in this world or striving to get right with God, but purpose that I am right with God and I get to love Him and honor Him and the people He puts in front of me every day and the strength to accomplish those things or to get through the challenges of life.
Yeah, similar to this, the spiritual nutrition and energy and power to live for Him and to serve others.
Yeah. Just like eating a good loaf of bread fills you up with the energy that you need for life each day, filling up on the bread of life gives me the faith and the heart and the energy, the motivation to live each day with my Savior and for my Savior. I think you're getting the point. Just like we are often going to be concerned about what we put into our body, we also ought to be concerned about what we put into our souls and our hearts. As we see today, Jesus offers us a bread, a living bread, a bread that gives life, that has the perfect ingredients of our Savior Jesus, who draws us to our Lord and gives us the eternal benefits as He feeds our souls of having life and forgiveness eternally in Him. And so my friends, keep eating of this bread. Enjoy this bread because it's free and it is yours in abundance. This is even more bread than Jesus gave to the 5,000. This bread for you each day, and may you be filled, and may you be strengthened to live with your Savior through that bread. Let's join together in thanking God for this and offering up our prayers. Is there anything on your hearts and minds that you would like to include in prayer today?
My cousin Matt is having open heart surgery tomorrow.
Pray for him. Please.
My aunt had multiple brain surgeries this past week, so a prayer for her recovery that they don't have to go back in.
Absolutely. Very good. Anything else?
The hurricane headed toward Haiti tomorrow.
Yeah, we'll remember the people of Haiti who are not just suffering from a major earthquake, but now a hurricane coming their way too. We'll pray for these things. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for feeding us the bread of life and for showing us what actually goes into the bread of life, that through Jesus, we have the perfect ingredient. We have a Savior who lived and died for us and did what we could not accomplish, and that you freely give of this bread so that we may eat and through faith believe and have life. For in the bread of life, we find that our sins are completely forgiven. We find your grace, we find your mercy, we find your love, we find forgiveness, we find peace and hope, and remove all our guilt and shame from us. Remind us each day to feed on this bread, and strengthen us through this message that we may know you more and more and live each day empowered and strengthened to serve you and to love the people that you set before us. In those moments when we slip, in those moments of the bad spiritual diet habits come back into our lives, help us to put those off to the side and to find our strength and peace in you. Lord, we ask that you would be with those among us who are hurting and in need of your watchful eye and care. Be with Abby's cousin Matt, who is going to be undergoing open heart surgery this week. Bless the doctors and those who care for him, and let the surgery be a success and give him strength and recovery. Be with Kieran's aunt, who underwent surgery this last week, and give her strength and recovering too, that she may return to full health. Lord, we also ask that you be with the people of Haiti, those who are suffering loss of either life or home and things like that in this earthquake that just took place there. And as they look at an impending tropical storm, maybe even a hurricane, we ask that you watch over them and protect them in all things, Lord. May all the people in these situations turn to you and find in you a source of strength and peace and comfort, even when the body and the world around them doesn't bring them that joy. Be with them and watch over them as we entrust them into your hands. And be with us as we go our separate ways today, that we may find joy in you and opportunities to serve and love you in our world around us. We ask this all in our Savior Jesus' name. Let's join together in our closing song this morning, a song called Cornerstone. And again, I'll invite you to join up, to stand up and to join in singing as you feel comfortable.
Seems to hide his face.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ,